Hello, welcome to how to create online exhibits. This is a nuts and bolts webinar created by the Association of Midwest Museums and VAMONDE. First, my name is Charity Counts. I'm the executive director for the Association of Midwest Museums. I'm one of the presenters today and am joined by a couple of other members and partners to give this presentation. We're glad you can join us. I continue to be grateful for members and providers who have been willing to help us create online programs or provide them to members and museum professionals beyond the AMM network. I'd like to invite my co-presenters to introduce themselves now. Kathy, we'll start with you. Please share who you are and what you do and where you work.
Sure, I'm Kathy Hamaker and I am a exhibit developer. I do consulting work under the LLC Leonid Production. And I do content development, interactive development, accessibility consulting. I worked at the Children's Museum of Indianapolis for many years, so I have a lot of experience with a lot of different types of exhibits and topics and traveling and permanent and all that kind of thing. So I'm very excited to be part of this panel.
Thanks, Kathy. Kartik, we'll go with you next.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kartik Ramkumar. I'm the Director of Customer Success at VAMONDE. And in my role, I really work with museums around the country, especially in the Midwest, since we're based in Chicago, on their digital strategy and building great virtual exhibition content. My role really ensures that museums are successful with their digital strategy and can use our digital tools that we provide to museums effectively to achieve their goals. You'll see a bit of our tools later on in this webinar. Thanks, Charity.
Thank you, Kartik. Great. And again, I'm Charity Counts with AMM. I just give you a little bit of background on me. Prior to working with AMM, I was the head of exhibits at the Children's Museum of Indianapolis and worked with Kathy. So we've got a long history of doing exhibits together of all types. All right, we thought before we dive into the content of our webinar, we would take a moment to address sort of reasons why you might be interested in having an online exhibit or considering it right now. I've been on many phone calls with members in the last few weeks, and I know this conversation is happening everywhere. So I've heard different reasons, different things that people want to do. Among them is maybe you recently opened an exhibit and then you had to close your doors right away. So I've heard this a few different times across the region. I think that people are looking for alternative ways to share the content they had in exhibits that are now not accessible to visitors because everyone is at home with social distancing. You may also want to just simply make sure that you stay relevant right now or address at-home education and activity needs that families, members, donors, and others may have. So that could be through offering new content. Maybe you want to provide access to the collection in ways that you hadn't before. Maybe you want to find ways to use content you've created in the past and organize them in new ways and or thematic programs and exhibits. It's also possible that you want to use online exhibits right now as an opportunity to pilot topics or test content for future exhibits. Of course, we're sure that there are many other reasons possible. These are just a few. Our first segment today is really a reminder for how to create great exhibits. And I want to mention now that if you have questions for the panelists as we go, we ask that you save them to the end, or at least the end of each segment will prompt you to ask questions at the time. So hang on to those. We'll try to present and then get to those questions as soon as we can. So to talk a little bit about what makes a great in-person experience is Kathy.
Yeah, so Charity asked me to join this webinar mainly to just kind of remind us all that even in this sort of crisis point that we're at, where we're all kind of freaking out about needing to move a lot of our operations to online, that a good exhibit experience is still a good exhibit experience, right? Your your audience is the first thing that you need to think about. It's not just, oh my God, I have to get some content up online. You still need to start with the big questions, such as, you know, who am I actually doing this for? You know, is it your regular audience? You know, is it for schools specifically? Is it going to be, you know, is your audience generally adults or children? Because all of that affects what you say and how you say it. You know, we've kind of called out here a few of the sort of bullet points under that, that, you know, if you want to do something that's addressing the needs of school groups who are trying to still get content out there, then you need to, you know, think about what grade level is it? Are they aware of your topic? What's age appropriate? You know, even depending on whether you're used to producing content specifically for schools or specifically for children at a certain grade level, you know, even thinking about the vocabulary that you're using, and is it fourth grade reading level or second grade reading level or adult, you know, if that's really your audience, it's just having all that at the back of your mind is always important, whether you're online or in person. And then, you know, the question of storyline, you know, it's not just throwing a bunch of your collection online and hoping that people will look at it. It's about, you still want to have some sort of big idea, some sort of, why should people be interested in this? Why, you know, what's the messaging you're trying to get out there? And so getting that, getting your ducks in a row for that is I think far even more important online, because you're only communicating through visual, some audio, but you know, your way of communication is somewhat more limited than it is when you're on the floor in your museum. And so making sure that your storyline is tight and compelling, and that you have these enduring questions that are driving what you're doing is still every bit as key online as it is offline. Another point that we wanted to hit, although this seems kind of obvious, is it needs to be visually interesting. You know, in a real gallery, you're thinking a lot about space arrangement and floor plan and color and text. And there's no reason that you shouldn't be thinking about that in a similar sense as you're working on an online presentation, because you want to keep people's attention. You don't want them to just kind of click around randomly and then go, ugh, and move on to something else. So having a variety of different types of elements for people to interact with or read or do, having a design and environment that's cohesive. And then also to, you know, even online, you can think about a floor plan, if you will. You can think about arranging different sort of areas or spaces that people who want to drill further into content can do that and explore areas of your online presentation in more depth, you know, from your sort of main site. Hierarchy of information, obviously we talk about that a lot in the context of labels and label writing, but even, I think even more so on the web, where people could just as easily, you know, go click over to look at the what's the weather going to be today website, you really need to very clearly lay out what's your exhibit about, what's important, not what's not important at all, or presumably you wouldn't actually be putting it on there if it's not important at all, but kind of what's really your key messages, and think about, you know, focusing your words, keeping it short, keeping it tight, chunking it out. This is a phrase we use a lot, because really it's, you know, you want to make sure that you have your information in these sort of digestible chunks of, oh, that's what this is about. Oh, I'm interested in that. Or I'm not interested in that. I want to move on to something else. You know, you're trying to make it as approachable as possible for your visitor by making sure all your key points are emphasized, making sure that your messages are emphasized, and then all the fascinating little details, you know, kind of waterfall down underneath that.
Kathy, just to add to your point there, it's also a little bit about making sure that your visitors, you know, in person or online, are not exhausted by this experience, right? It's
right.
Exhibit fatigue is a real thing.
Yeah, and if your online presence looks like a Wikipedia page, obviously there are going to be people who want to read your entire Wikipedia page, but you know, that's not necessarily what's going to help people figure out whether or not it's worth their time investing in, you know, sitting down and going through your web offering. And then the last thing we wanted to just kind of hit here is the accessibility question, partially because a lot of what we think about in physical exhibits is physical accessibility, right? You know, we think about wheelchair turnaround space and reach and all that kind of thing. Online, to some extent, because people are using their own devices to get access to your content, you know, they already have some tools at their disposal that meet their personal needs. But that's not to take all the responsibility off of us as the content developers to really think about whether what we're presenting is fully accessible. So thinking in terms of, you know, you still want to present stuff that works for people with different types of learning styles and different access points. So text, but also images, and also audio narration as available. Providing rich descriptions of visual elements that you may have, you know, a 2D photo of, but you know, doing rich description where you're verbally describing what it is that you'd be looking at if you were in the gallery, I think is an absolutely essential add-on when you're doing an online experience. We threw in test your designs in Koblis because this is one of my favorite tools as far as checking both hard copy label design, but also checking web pages to see how your color choices look with different types of color blindness. The reason I like Koblis is because it offers you actually multiple types of color blindness, including some of the more rare ones. But still, you can look at an image and say, oh, that contrast does not work at all for red-green color blindness or other types. So that's an awesome free tool that's online, that's linked there. And then, you know, the same things that apply to regular graphic design apply twice as much to web design because you've got less space and more potential for busyness, I think. So, you know, think about what fonts you're choosing. Think about clarity. Think about contrast. And make sure that everything that you're doing works for as large a slice of your audience as possible, because why wouldn't you, right? You do it in person, so you do it online.
Kathy, one thing I want to add for sure for the last slide in making your online exhibit accessible is that importance of different access points and multiple learning styles, I think, is really key. A lot of museums that we work with just start off with, excuse me, pictures and text, and that's what they keep because that's what's on their exhibit walls, but really incorporating video, AR, VR if you can, audio, all of that together provides such an immersive experience that not only benefits the user in helping them learn from the content better, but also allows you to create a more holistic experience like what they would see in your actual physical exhibit.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think there's so many ways to provide those different access points too that, you know, it definitely can feel a little overwhelming almost, but it's essential, I think, to the experience.
Well, thinking about online experiences, Kathy, you want to run us through just a few ideas here we had, kind of key points related to that. Rules maybe that apply to online elements already that work here.
Yeah, sure. So thinking about kind of best practice, and we're drawing on a couple of different sources here, but thinking about stuff like your text length, you know, we're back to chunking, right? You're chunking out your text into 50 to 60 word paragraphs maximum so that it doesn't look overwhelming. And keeping your total length to 200 to 350 words on a topic. 500 is a lot. You know, that's 10 of those paragraphs, right? But really just being aware of the fact that many people find large blocks of text intimidating. And this is, I think, twice as true on web-based interfaces. If you're going to use video, usually if we're doing video in a gallery, 90 seconds is the maximum because people are standing, people are distracted by other things. Obviously online, some people are conditioned to watch way longer videos, but I would still suggest breaking down, if you have a topic, breaking it into shorter clips, kind of module style, so that your audience can say, you know what, I already know all about this aspect of World War II. I want to skip directly to this particular module that interests me, so they don't have to watch a 9-minute video start to finish to get to content that they're really interested in. So, you know, making it customizable is great. Formatting, thinking about always captioning, always using rich descriptions, you know, making it as accessible as possible for hearing impaired folks or sight impaired folks. Make sure your fonts are easy to read. Again, high contrast is great. Building things in layers so that you have kind of multiple spaces to visit. You're not throwing all of your content onto a single page and expecting everybody to just scroll through the whole thing. You know, break it up and break it out. And I think Vamon will have some suggestions about that. And then finally, keeping in mind that depending on whether people are using their phones or their laptops or a desktop, they may have a very different experience of what you've created. For instance, if you've created it as an app, you are, you know, limiting yourself to the folks who can get to it through a smartphone. You know, that may be fine with you. That may be what you want, but just being aware of what platforms people may be trying to get to your museum through, and then adjusting yourself appropriately.
Thanks, Kathy. Kartik, anything to add?
Yeah, I have a couple of things that I want to add. One thing that I work with a lot of museums on is especially layout. So a lot of them have met the requirements for text length, video length, pictures, all of their medias together, but they don't think enough about how to arrange it within each of those different layers or spaces so that the users engage throughout and actually participates throughout from start to finish of all of your content. You want to keep the user's engagement through your as much of your exhibit as you can. So really thinking about how you're structuring all of the different media elements and content that you're putting together is going to be really key as well for building online experiences. And the last thing I want to talk about is building a sort of logical flow. You want to chunk it out into multiple spaces for people to visit, but if your spaces kind of jump around or back and forth or don't have a clear message throughout that you're connecting it with, it can be hard for a user to follow through your entire exhibit. So think about that broader goal, the broader objective, and what connects all of those different spaces, exhibits together, I would say are a couple of my recommendations as well.
Thanks, Kartik. I want to mention one thing here. I've put it on the slide for everybody's reference. The Chicago Cultural Accessibility Consortium is hosting a webinar tomorrow that happens to be sold out, that's about creating accessible experiences online. They are going to be sharing a link with AMM, so we'll get it posted on our website as well and make it available to folks. So do watch for that in the coming week as another sort of layer to tack on to this presentation today. Now, before we go on to the next segment, I want to go ahead and address some questions. I have a question that came through the Q&A. I also saw somebody had raised their hand, but I'm going to start with a question that's typed out in the Q&A box. This is Ashley Mason Burns. She asks, what is the best way to go about getting permission for audio or video clips to add to your virtual experience that you do not own? That's a good question, Ashley. We're going to talk about that a little bit later in the presentation, but I'll go ahead and mention here that a lot of the video platforms like YouTube and Vimeo, they have a Creative Commons notation that people can label videos that they produce as Creative Commons. So those are often searchable and you can kind of see what's out there that may just be rights free, essentially, for you to use. If you're going to use other videos, it's generally okay if you're citing the source and giving credit where credit is due. But you know, that's something definitely to be careful about and talk to your counsel about potentially, depending on the situation. Another question is, do you have any examples of amazing online exhibits? That'll be the next segment we get into. So I'm gonna save that for the next section. And then examples of multiple spaces. Yes, I see this question in the chat. We'll definitely be addressing some different formats people have used. And then someone else has asked, I've been treating my own social media posts as practice exhibit labels as a Facebook or Instagram post. Is that a useful model for online exhibit labels? Kathy, you wanna respond to that?
Sure. I feel like, yeah, it's not a bad place to start because of course Facebook and Instagram offer you that chance to really be short and punchy, although not everybody does on social media, but generally, you know, that social media is kind of short format. I think it just depends on what are you really trying to get across with your label, because social media does have that very informal feel to it. And so if you're wanting to have that kind of slightly more authoritative voice, sometimes Facebook and Instagram feel a little bit more, hey, how you doing? And so it depends on the voice you want to try to convey with your information. And it probably depends on your subject matter.
Thanks, Kathy. All right, we're gonna move on to the next segment. Again, if you have other questions come up, you can save them till our next prompt. For this next segment, we're gonna actually take a look at typical formats and elements of online exhibits using some real world examples. So we're gonna kind of take a tour of online exhibits out there by museums. I've done a little bit of searching online, just looking at a variety of different types to pull this segment together. And some of the examples are from the Midwest and some are not. So we're just gonna kind of dive right in here. I do wanna point out that there are a few different sort of categories of online exhibits, at least as I would define them, based on what I have seen out there. I feel like these are pretty standard categories and what you're planning may fit into one of these. One, and probably one of the more common ones, is to just have a web page on the organization's website that is the home of a online exhibit. Some places have dedicated websites where it's an entirely separate website URL for their project, for their exhibit. Some try to build exhibits within their online collections databases. And then others use apps and other platforms to put the exhibits out there and organize them. We're gonna start with web pages on an organization's website. So one example is the Girl Museum. The Girl Museum is an entirely online museum. They use web pages on their website for the structure of their exhibits. You can see across time and space here, one of their exhibits. When you click on the icon for this exhibit on their website, you're taken to this first page where you get to explore or learn more about the topic. Just a kind of an overview, an introduction, if you will. As you click through or scroll down, you'll discover that there are images, artworks that are featured with just a little bit of a snippet of information. As you click on these, you can go further in and learn more about the work of art and how it connects to a portrayal of girls across time and space, which is what this exhibit is about. Another example of a web page on an organization's website is the National World War I Museum in Kansas City. They have multiple exhibits and different web pages for each of them. This is an example of one that has used layers. So this is the Christmas Truce Winter 1914 exhibit. You can see on their sort of home page for the exhibit within their website, there's an introduction, an essay section, explore accounts and incidents and stories, and then declare or support a Christmas truce. So there's sort of three layers that you can dive into from this main page. I've shown one or two paths here. One is that if you chose explore accounts and incidents and stories and click, you get to another page with different sort of teasers, options to choose from. And as you select them, they open up pages like this one. So I chose from one of the six Gordons. And this is what came up. It shows, you know, a picture of a page from a book and then has a story associated with it. One of their other options, which I would consider to be an activity, is to declare or support a Christmas truce. So here you can see, when you go to this page, you see lots of little topics, truces that people have declared or put out there that you can then choose to sign on to. So, you know, maybe an end to police violence. There are some that are a little bit sillier, like hipsters and everyone else, you know, various topics here, but they've allowed people to kind of offer up some truces themselves. And then you can kind of see how many people have signed on. As far as dedicated websites go, I have a couple examples here. One is the Jane Addams Hull House Museum, worked with community collaborators and students to create this exhibit called Look at It This Way. They've got a similar sort of setup of layers, only they've set it out in a separate website. So that's branded separate from their own and has you know, different pages within it. There's an about page, you can learn more about the project itself, and then you can click on any of these options in the menu and see an object and the description and stories, quotes, various contributions from community members. This example is a partnership, a collaboration between the Google Arts and Culture website and platform and British Library that recently launched. I think it's fairly new. This is the Harry Potter History of Magic. So they've drawn on objects and archival materials from the British Library to create this. When you go to the whole website, there are lots of different options. It is definitely a rabbit hole. You could spend a lot of time here if you wanted to. As you scroll down, you see a variety of options, prompts that, you know, suggest that you can read on, learn more about something, a topic or an object that's featured. And then as you go into it further, you find things like this, which I thought this was a really fun activity. This is a scroll that when you go to the page and scroll down, bits of information come up. And then as you scroll further, it zooms in on certain sections. So it kind of is highlighting key pieces of the scroll that they want you to really look at and understand. This platform, this particular structure and setup was really complex. This is a lot, and I'm sure they worked on it for a very long time. So don't anybody feel like you need to be there right now if you've not done an online exhibit before. I've also seen some examples of online collections databases that do more than allow you to search for different objects in the collection. Many of them will have a search, but then some have, you know, organized things into categories of the type of object. Actually, many collections databases that are online, you will see something like this that is at the J. Paul Getty Museum. Or this is an example of the Nelson Atkins Museum of Art. This is, if you click to woodcuts, this is what you get. But I noticed that places like the Chinese Historical Society of America, they've actually created little stories and vignettes and exhibits on their collections database as well. Likely you can do this through different tags with your objects in your collection. Depending on what platform you use for this, there are different ways to organize them and get them to pull up under these categories. As far as apps and other platforms go, you know, sometimes museums have used these or are beginning to use them for online exhibits because they already have them in place. If you've got an app that is really meant to be a guide for your visitors when they visit the museum, maybe it has audio tours or other features, but now people can't come, you can use the platform as an opportunity to push out additional information or to remind people that they can still see your collection. They can see their favorite objects by visiting the app or visiting the museum sort of virtually via the app. Sometimes these will have, you know, virtual tours in them or other opportunities to kind of look at the backside of an object, spin them around 3D. Those things are great to encourage people to do that might just be existing already. Although you can use these platforms to add new content and create new opportunities for them and push that out as well. I know there are a variety of app companies, you know, OnSell and Curate, QZM, Catalogit, VAMONDE, who's helping us today. that have apps and web-based options too. So there are a variety of ways people could access the content, not just through the app. The downside, I would say, probably with going with apps as, you know, as the primary source of engagement, is that it may only be accessible to, you know, people who have the app already or whoever can get the app. As Kathy mentioned earlier, that you know, may or may not matter too much with for your goals, but it just that's something definitely to keep in mind. If people right now don't have smart devices to download it, you may not get new participation. It'll likely be people who are already accessing this sort of activity generally. So something to keep that in mind. It might be a good idea if you are thinking about using apps and other platforms to share this sort of content, create online exhibits, to go ahead and have links to videos maybe that are found out there on your website too, so people can access them on YouTube and other places as an alternative strategy for sharing. So just something to keep in mind. We've asked Kartik to share a little bit more about the VAMONDE app and some examples of exhibits within their platform, so you can kind of see how they've helped people to build things. Kartik, I'm going to hand that over to you to share. Let me know if you want to go through the slides first, or if you want to just go ahead and share your screen and go straight to the websites.
Great. Thank you, Charity. I want to start off with just a little introduction of VAMONDE. So VAMONDE offers free digital tools for museums in order to build online exhibits, virtual tours, content for social media and engagement, anything and everything you can think of in terms of digital content. But in terms of focusing on online exhibitions and creating those on VAMONDE, we offer a easy to use digital tool where museums can just come sign up, come to bring all of their materials into the platform and just input them, and it'll create a mobile and web version of their digital tour or online exhibit, excuse me, that they can then share with their communities, out to social media, put it on their website. Anything and everything is possible. But I did want to go through a few examples of ways that museums and cultural institutions have used VAMONDE specifically for creating online exhibits. The first example I want to start off with is the Old Town School of Folk Music. I'll share my screen and pull these up on the website in just a second. But the Old Town School of Folk Music is a center for music education with a long history in the Chicago area. It's been around for about 100 years. It has shifted to various neighborhoods. It's touched various parts of Chicago's history. And Old Town School came to VAMONDE and wanted to create an online exhibit that showcased their history in an interesting, interactive, and collaborative way, and increase access to the broader community, not just their students who are taking classes at the school, but also people in the Chicago area who should know about this history. They brought together pictures from their digital collection, like you can see on the web page here, text, video, links, all of that material together, and built this virtual tour that not only includes major events in their history, but also touches on major events in Chicago's history as well, and how it connects to Old Town School. It's available on both web and mobile, and you can see kind of how the formatting looks on your phone and then versus the website. I'm going to go through the rest of the examples and then pull the exhibit up on my screen for you to walk through how they structured it and how they built it out. The next example is the Design Museum of Chicago. They took 3 months to plan and execute their new exhibit on called Keep Moving, which is about the Chicago's bicycle history and design. And so they spent a lot of time putting together the actual physical exhibit in their museum space, and then their exhibit had to close. And so they decided to convert that physical exhibition into an online exhibit where people could still interact with the different sections of their exhibit. but can do it from the comfort of their own homes or walk around, as you can see from the map feature up there, to the sites that connect to their exhibit topic. So as you can see here, the map shows all the different points in the Chicago region that connect to the exhibit on Chicago's bicycle history. Each of those sections down there at the bottom are different sections of their exhibit that they've converted into an online page or an online section. Lastly, you can see on the web.
Karthik, I'm gonna pause you for just a second. It looks like we have had another technical challenge here. I'm gonna stop my share and share again because I've got some of our attendees saying they can't see the presentation again. So I'm gonna just stop the share and start it again. Hopefully that gets us back on track.
Is that better?
All right, are we back on? Can everybody see apps and other platforms continued? Okay, great, we're back on.
Okay, awesome. Thank you for bearing with us. The last example that I want to talk through is from the Helena Museum, which is a very small regional museum located in northern Arkansas. They turn to VAMONDE as a way to combine different objects in their collection to brainstorm new exhibit ideas. So they had a series of about a couple thousand objects. They had one exhibit that they've had for 10 plus years. And they decided, okay, we want to try something new. We don't want to spend the time building it out in our physical space. So we're going to use an online exhibit as a way to bring together some of these ideas, put it together using pictures, text, video, and see if we can create an online exhibit that is popular so that we can then convert it into a physical exhibit. I'm going to share my screen, Charity, if it's okay now, so that I can pull these up live on my and walk through the actual tour, the actual online exhibits live on the platform.
And just to clarify for listeners, I think I saw a question about this in the chat. The way that VAMONDE works, it is a web-based platform that you can build, essentially a website that also works in the app. So it kind of is dual purpose. It's both things.
Yep. So if you build your online exhibit on VAMONDE, it's available both on web and mobile. I pulled it up on the website here. So this is the Old Town School of Folk Music tour that I spoke about earlier. Basically how they've separated it out is just going chronologically. So they started with the roots of the Old Town School going all the way to present day and the major events that happened. What I thought was really well done about this was really the use of a lot of their historical images. They had a great digital collection that they leveraged in order to bring this exhibit together and put it live on the platform. So as you can see, they started off with some text, interspersed video and pictures along the way to chunk it out, as the expression goes. And since this is a music school, I think music and especially videos of famous performers, of classes, it was a really important tool that they used in adding to their exhibit and making sure that their online exhibit was both accessible, but also interactive and engaging. Lastly, I want to share the Helena Museum. So they brought together a couple of different objects within their collection and decided to build an exhibit called The Oldest History in Arkansas, in their region of Arkansas. And they essentially built an online exhibit that included pieces from their collection that necessarily didn't connect together, but shaped an overall theme around the furthest history that they had within their collection, and talked about that era, that space and time, and the objects that they had collected that were part of the history and founding of their area as well. So those were the different kind of exhibits and reasons that museums and cultural institutions used VAMONDE as a way to build their online exhibition.
Great, thanks, Karthik. We just wanted to quickly go over some of the common elements we found in these examples. And before we go on to the next segment and ask questions, First of all, as you could see, everybody's using an organizing theme or topic. They've often got written content, lots of images or image galleries. They could be images that were new or repurposed. That images include photos of people, places, and things, works of art or details from works of art, objects from their collection, also archival materials, embedded videos, new or repurposed. Some of these have been experts explaining a concept, staff members giving a tour, image slideshows, and so on and so forth. Very few of the examples that I found in my searching just generally of online exhibits include activities, although some places have had either at-home activity suggestions or even school activity suggestions or digital games. That varies. We'll kind of go through that a little bit more in a moment. But from the examples that we saw, I'm curious, before we go on, I know we've got a few questions in this box. We'll get to it. I'm curious when we go to talk a little bit about creative ideas here soon, we'll be able to think about things that we would like to see in exhibits. First, let's answer these questions. Kathy, this is a question that kind of goes back to some of the comments you had about audiences. Ashley Stevens asks, we used to use demographics to determine target audiences. Now we use a visitor experience model. Do you have any examples of visitor experience segments as opposed to demographics?
Wow, I'm not entirely sure what's meant by visitor experience segments. I tend to think about, you know, the visitor experience as being at least partially driven by demographics, but I am thinking more age than other types of demographics. Charity, do you have a better sense of what we're getting at here?
No, but I invite Ashley, if you want to add any clarification to your question by posting a sub question to the box. I'm guessing this has to do with more deciding what the experience should be based on what you want visitors to do and see versus the who it's for necessarily, but we'll let you add some clarification to the question maybe and see if we can get it answered. Meanwhile, we'll move on to another set of questions here more related to the apps and platforms. One person asked if we have any advice for on platforms and apps for organizations who might not already have online initiatives in place. One of the reasons why we're partnered with VAMONDE today is that their platform is one that people could quickly implement. It's free to AMM members. There are options for museums everywhere, even Canadian museums, to answer somebody else's question, to be able to use that platform to try this out. I, as far as advice goes, I think it's worth, you know, looking at how each platform requires that you build. I think many of them kind of look like website builders in the back end. So you might want to do what's going to be comfortable to you and your team as far as building and skill sets available on your team to do that. And then I don't personally have experience with every type of platform that you can use out there and if there are any that are better than others. But, you know, definitely do a little bit of research, watch some tutorials before you make a decision, I would say. We've got another question. Well, anybody want to add to that? Karthik, anything you want to say there?
Yeah. So in terms of advice on platforms and apps, before you choose a platform and app, I would say really spending some time with your team or with your thinking through your museum goals and strategy and why you want to pursue online content or online exhibits, right? Really setting a defined goal and really setting a defined piece of content that you want to work on, that you want to accomplish as a final product. I've worked with museums who have pursued a very vague digital or online strategy, and they don't really see a clear goal in mind and therefore are just trying out different platforms, aren't really sure of the process or where to go. And it becomes quite a frustrating process. So I would say start off with that really kind of deep dive and reflection on where your museum is at, what you're really looking for from online exhibits and online platforms, and then go to trying a couple of different platforms out, seeing if they work well for you, or testing it out, starting with social and testing it out there and seeing if that content is really resonating with your audience as well.
Kartik, another question that you may be best suited to answer. We have got somebody who's asking about analytics. Are there better or worse tools to use for gathering and reporting analytics or quote unquote visitation to online formats?
Yeah, so VAMONDE actually has a really robust analytics platform. We'll walk through how to build a digital tour and the digital tools available at, after this section of the webinar. So I'll get to that in a couple minutes, but we do offer a really comprehensive analytics tool that includes demographics, visitor information, maps of where people are viewing it from. So there's a lot of information that you can get through analytics of how many people are visiting your content and how much time they're spending on it.
Great, thank you. Got some clarification, Kathy, on that, the question from Ms. Stevens. The description of visitor experience segments is looking at what visitors are wanting to experience at the museum instead of looking at age groups or demographics. So I think this relates kind of to more of a marketing style, thinking about audience personas, where you are sort of describing them. So people with curious minds or people seeking to learn and discover more about a topic or experience. And then friends and family groups, maybe broad groups of friends and family who are gathering for time together. They seek passive enjoyment of an experience. So there's some examples that she gave. So yeah. how might you might take that into consideration with an online exhibit?
The interesting thing right now, of course, is that at least in almost every state in the U.S. right now, the situation with social distancing has kind of sliced those distinctions in a, we're slicing the bread loaf a little bit different, right? Because there are school age kids who are, you know, being kind of turned loose to do educational stuff on the internet. There are structured experiences that they're supposed to be having. There are, you know, home directed things where the parents are trying to direct them. And so you've got all those different types of folks that you're calling out there in those examples, but right now they're all taking in content in a slightly alien way, I would say. In that, not that they're a captive audience, because they don't have to come to your website, but I sort of think that you know, looking at those sort of distinctions at the moment, you know, if we're talking about what you're doing right now to address the issues of our museums being closed, what you're really looking at is slices of, are people trying to have a formal educational experience? You know, are they trying to keep their kids entertained while they're, you know, working from home? Are they, you know, wanting to just, you know, decide where they're going to go first when they finally get out of the house again? So I think those types of categories are a little bit more challenging at the moment because everyone's experience of visiting your museum, quote unquote, is a little bit different right now. Does that make sense?
I think that's great, Kathy. Thank you. We're going to keep going. Just paying attention to time here and making sure that we get through the last few sections of our presentation. Any questions we're not able to answer today, and hopefully we'll have a few more minutes toward the end, we'll go ahead and include an FAQ for those. So feel free to keep posting them into the Q&A box. We'll get to them as soon as we can, if not after. All right, we're going to look at some creative ideas for reaching beyond the status quo. This is kind of building on my point earlier that we, you know, looking at the online examples that we saw already and kind of what's out there, people are producing and sharing right now, they all have very similar structures. So what can we do to maybe make our online exhibits a little bit more interesting, consider it sort of upgrade on the typical formats? So we put together kind of a list of things, you know, things you could see and then things you could do potentially as a visitor to an online exhibit. You know, inviting them to click to dive deeper rather than placing all the content on a single page. And I think we've all given this advice throughout the presentation, but definitely something to keep in mind. Think of it in layers. Make it accessible. So taking into consideration advice that Kathy has shared, seeking more advice on how to make sure that people with different needs can access the information. Feature multiple points of view or tell stories from varying learning levels and audiences. You might choose to use Prezi or whiteboard explainer videos to animate content versus having paragraphs of text. So think about different ways of delivering messages. Reuse freely licensed or publicly available content and cite the source. Try using infographics to convey facts instead of text. Not sure what's happened with my presentation here. All right. Some more ideas, things to do. you can add interactives like games or online versions of digital elements that are in your other exhibits. Sometimes you've got a beta version, some other version that can work well in that way. You can provide do-it-yourself activities. So I mentioned some places have posted videos or described activities that you could do at home. I've seen printable coloring pages on online exhibits as well. You can offer virtual tours of a place or space featured in the story. So if somebody can actually tour through, say if you've got a historic building that's part of your exhibit and you want people to explore that or find a virtual tour of a place that you're talking about somewhere else in the world, you can include it. Try the interactive or scrolling timelines. I'm not usually one to suggest timelines for exhibits, but I think in an online situation where it helps to convey the information well, and you can make it interactive, that could be a lot of fun. Think about zoom or spin effects for images and artifacts, different ways of looking at them. Just really quickly, in this presentation, we've listed some sources for online activities. You can build games and things like the WISC online game builder, Quizlet Interact quiz tool is one I noticed Colonial Williamsburg was using to make quizzes and offer those as activities in their exhibits online. EduPlay is another one. It's a gamification tool. Many of these are used by teachers, so you can build your game, you know, have a different theme for your game, use them different, the same format over and over again in different exhibits that you're doing if you want. And then embed them in your online web page, on your website for the online exhibit. For other content, you might, you know, consider hiring an artist to help you create an explainer video. There's this online company where you can kind of get bids on projects like this called Fiverr, and there are others out there. Where you could have somebody do this pretty quickly, sometimes in 24 hours. So it's not something that necessarily adds time to your schedule. You can do slideshow presentations and turn them into videos. So PowerPoint allows you to do this. Prezi allows you to do this. You can also access Creative Commons. So here are some links, and we'll share this presentation with you and online after our program. But if you go to Vimeo Creative Commons YouTube, look for the Creative Commons notations. There's also a Creative Commons website where you can search videos that are out there already. I'm gonna keep going. We'll see if we can get to questions at the end. Just to kind of give you an idea for process, I had recently an online brainstorm with a group of members. And in that brainstorm, we tried out kind of brainstorming an online exhibit just so that I could kind of use what came out of that as an example here. And it was fun. We talked first about what we would want to see in any kind of exhibit about, in this case, pets. We chose pets, and then we kind of honed in on something called pet careers. And we talked a little bit about how, you know, pets and other domestic animals are trained to help or entertain us. And we wanted to think about an online exhibit, what that might include for that. So in this instance, we came up with some messages we might want to deliver. You know, our messages focus really on that pets are sometimes trained to do these things, and that they, the different types of animals have different skills and different abilities that make them well suited for different types of jobs, or conversely, not every animal can do every job, and that our community has many great stories about service animals. So this is where our collection comes in, thinking about our sort of imaginary exhibit here, a way that we might be able to incorporate that. We took a look at what we might want to feature. We talked about, you know, local stories. Maybe it's some that we have to collect, you know, while we're closed. Maybe it's stories that we already have through newspaper clippings or recorded commercials or videos. Maybe we can get other stories from community partners who maybe collect these types of stories too. And then we have members and volunteers who use service pets that may be good to feature. We talked about using photos and videos in our archive that show, you know, different animals in their service roles. And here we've kind of postulated that they date back to 1920. And then we talked about maybe needing to do some background research on this topic and really decide what we wanted to talk about with it and then be able to pull these materials together. We also wanted to be able to offer a game with our online exhibit using a free online tool. So when we went to kind of outline what this might look like, we said we're calling it, you know, this is my museum and it's Pet Careers online exhibit. We have these five sort of sections of the exhibit. There's introduction section, guide dog section, therapy animals, law enforcement and military animals, and then pets and entertainment. And then we, you know, thought about it as having the next layer in. When you click on introduction to pet careers, you get to a page that kind of looks like this, where we've organized, you know, sort of a message or a key statement we wanted to make. You can click to a photo gallery and look at pictures of service animals from our community, past to present, and then play a matching quiz game where you match different types of dogs and their natural abilities to the need or service they're most suited for. So this was just one example of an online exhibit we kind of outlined using processes and ideas that we shared here today. Now we can have Kartik kind of give us a quick overview of how we could do this with the VAMONDE platform. Kartik, want me to just stop sharing and you can show on your screen, or do you want to use the slides?
In the interest of time, I'll just show the slides if that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
So this is an image of the VAMONDE content creation platform. So this is where you can build your online exhibits. Once you have your organizing topic, your content, images, videos, links, this page shows you how you can input all of those different fields into your VAMONDE online exhibit. Those symbols up at the top are all the different types of content you can add. So there's text all the way to the left, pictures, video, call to action links. You can also add events that your museum is hosting, either virtual or in-person events, onto your content as well. There's a rating up at the top. You'll see those three stars that compares it to some of our best content. So you can actually get recommendations from VAMONDE on how to improve your online exhibit content as well. So the builder is very much like a WordPress builder or a Medium blog, how you would go about building one. So all you need to do is copy and paste your text in those fields that you see up above, and then add a picture by selecting it from your computer, add videos using links. So really easy to input and really easy to execute. With the interest of time, since I have to go a little bit quicker than I wanted to, if anybody is interested in walking through the platform with me in a little bit more detail, I'll share my contact information with Charity and she can share that out to schedule a meeting with me in person. Next up, I wanted to talk a little bit about the other tools that we offer. So a lot of I saw a lot of questions about analytics, how you evaluate content. This is the analytics platform that VAMONDE provides. On the summary report on the left, you can actually see how many people are opening your content. There's a time there, that's how much time people are spending on your content. You can see a web and mobile breakdown of how people are accessing your content, either through web or through the mobile app. And then the engagement button down at the bottom shows you how many people are engaging with your videos and links. So this type of content can be really useful in evaluating the results of your online exhibit and figuring out either how can I improve the results or how can I better my content so that I'm getting better results, especially with dwell time or engagement, and give you a more focused approach in building and constantly updating your online exhibit.
Great, thank you for that overview, Kartik. We have generated a resource page on our slides. And before we share the slideshow with you after the presentation as a follow-up email, we can add additional resources that people have asked for in the Q&A in the chat box. I've noticed questions about captioning audio clips for self-guided tours and things like that. We'll try to add some resources where we can in this as well. We do have questions that came up in the Q&A and in the chat box, and it may be best for us to get in touch with you directly with the answers to your questions and then include them in an FAQ supplement to our program today, just so that we can end this approximately on time. We're a few minutes over now. I feel like this has been really interesting and fun for me to learn from everybody working on this, thinking about online exhibits and how we translate what we know about creating exhibits overall to an online platform. I hope this was helpful to you, the listener, and that if you have any questions, I want you to know that you're welcome to reach out to any one of us on the panel as a follow-up. On the presenter's slide, I do want to point out that we did have our email addresses, so feel free to use that email. Kartik, Kathy, thanks so much for helping to prepare the presentation today. It's been great to learn from you and work with you on this.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you for having me. I'll share my contact info with Charity, and if anybody wants to get in contact with me about any questions that they may have, feel free to do so.
Great. Thank you both. Kathy, anything from you?
Thank you so much. This has been a pleasure. And you absolutely, if anyone wants to talk to me about, strategies for content development online or off, please feel free to contact me.
Great. All right. Thanks, everyone. Enjoy the rest of your week and your weekend.